Hello. Thank you. Hello and welcome. Welcome to the Mike Lazaridis Theater of Ideas here at Perimeter Institute for Theoretical Physics in Waterloo, Ontario, Canada. And welcome to this, the first of two special Convergence lectures here at Convergence. My name is Greg Dick. I'm the Director of Educational Outreach here at Perimeter, and it is my pleasure to welcome all of you here this evening, both those of you here in the live studio audience and those of you watching online, either on Perimeter's website or on one of our many science communication colleagues' websites around the globe. We are also very pleased to welcome many of our valued public and private partners who have joined us in the audience this evening, including representatives from the governments of Canada and Ontario, and many individuals, foundations, and corporate supporters. Tonight's lecture is part of a very special conference called Convergence. Convergence is an event that is bringing together some of the best minds in physics to probe the latest ideas and chart a new course for 21st century physics. I would like you to join me in thanking and acknowledging the presenting sponsor of Convergence, BMO Financial Group. Thank you. And now, we are so fortunate to have two eminent researchers here this evening who will explore the life and career of Emmy Noether, a noted mathematician who Einstein described as the most important woman in the history of mathematics. Tonight's lecture will have several components. We have two short presentations, about 25 minutes each, and will be followed by a panel-style question and answer. For the online audience, we have Dr. Kelly Foyle and her team of PI researchers at behind their keyboards in the chat zone, ready to engage in conversation throughout the duration of the lecture. If you want to participate in those discussions, use hashtag PIConvergence. And also, as always, I'll take a question or two from the Twitter feed at the end. And now, our first speaker is Dr. Peter Alver. Dr. Alver is from the University of Minnesota. He is a Harvard grad and currently serving as the head of the School of Mathematics at Minnesota. Dr. Oliver has authored five popular books and will begin the evening by exploring Noether's life and career and delving into the curious history of her theorems. Our second speaker is Dr. Ruth Gregory. Dr. Gregory is currently serving as a professor of cosmology and relativity at Durham University and is a longtime friend of Perimeter's. She holds a position as visiting fellow here at PI and has been a driving force behind Perimeter's commitment to increasing opportunities for women in physics through the Institute's Emmy Noether Circle. Dr. Gregory will share the lasting impact of Noether's theorems and how they connect to the Standard Model and Einstein's relativity. And now, to set the stage, we have a short 3-minute video prepared for you to introduce you to Emmy Noether and her theorems, prepared by Perimeter's Emmy Noether Circle, with the scientific guidance of PI faculty member Dr. Mina Arvanitaki. So, ladies and gentlemen, here's the video. gentlemen, please welcome to the stage Dr. Peter Ulver. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the welcome. It's a great honor and also a great pleasure for me to be here at the Perimeter Institute and have an opportunity to talk about this incredible woman, incredible mathematician, and one of my all-time heroes in the world of mathematics. I want to give, in the 25 minutes that I talk, a little outline of the mathematical side of Noether's theorem, and then Ruth will give you the physics side of her work. Let me begin with three references. The first one is the famous paper of Emmy Noether, published in 1918. So although we're not quite at the centenary of the paper, we are at the centenary of when she was coming up with her ideas behind her two important theorems. As we will see, there's a very curious history of these theorems, and I started to investigate when I was writing my own book, and one of the things I learned, and I've learned this in all areas of mathematics, if you really want to understand a subject, you have to go back to the original source. So in this case, it was reading Noether's paper in the original German. Fortunately, I'd learned some German. But there's a nice English translation of it in a recent book written by a good friend of mine, Yvette Kosman-Schwarzbach, that goes in great detail over this very curious history and also in the about her two theorems. Here, of course, you already saw one of the pictures. This is a picture a bit later in her life. I think this is from around the time or close to the time that she was coming up with her theorems. We already saw the quote from Einstein. Fraulein Noether was the most significant creative mathematician thus far produced since the higher education of women began. And then Hermann Weyl, who was one of the great mathematicians of the 20th century, but also had a major impact in physics himself, in symmetry and quantum mechanics, says she was a great mathematician, the greatest, I firmly believe, her sex has ever produced, and a great woman. And of all I have known, she was certainly one of the happiest. Now, if you ask most mathematicians, myself excepted, I should give a caveat. I am not a physicist, I'm a mathematician. That's why I'm talking on the mathematical side of things. So I was very influenced by her theorems in my work, but most mathematicians would have this reaction. This is a famous algebraist from the middle of the 20th century. Emmy Noether was one of the most influential mathematicians of the century. But he doesn't mention her theorems. He says the development of abstract algebra, which is one of the most distinctive innovations of 20th century mathematics, is largely due to her in published papers, lectures, and personal influence of her contemporaries. And any of us who have struggled with abstract algebra in our bachelor's degree or PhD degrees in mathematics have Emmy Noether to either thank or to blame for that experience. So this is similar. This is a typical mathematical tribute to Emmy Noether. And if you look in the table of contents, I don't know how clear it is, there's a very short, and I would say not very good, short section about the calculus of variations, which I'll explain as her influence of her theorems, but most of it is about her influence in Galois theory, commutative ring theory, et cetera, et cetera. But that's not what we're here to celebrate. We're here to celebrate her theorems. So let me briefly give you a timeline of Emmy Noether. Her father was a mathematician, quite well known in algebraic geometry, named Max Noether. Emmy was under pressure from her family and her teachers to follow a typical female career path at the time, which meant getting married and having a family, perhaps teaching if that didn't quite work out in secondary school. But to her, she got no doubt in part influenced by her father, she couldn't resist the lure of mathematics. And so he arranged for her to take courses, to audit courses at the university, and she ended up doing a PhD under another fairly famous mathematician, Paul Gordon, in an area called classical invariant theory. Again, a very theoretical area. And she was at that time in her career, she was a great calculator. This was before we had things like Mathematica and other computational tools, and she calculated all 331 invariants of what's called a ternary biquadratic form. But she subsequently disavowed her thesis, and she called it Formelgestrüpp, which you can try to translate, or mist, which translates to manure. So this was her opinion of her own thesis. And in fact, in reaction to the thesis is primarily why she went and developed this very abstract approach to algebra later on. Because she was a woman, and because she only had a PhD at the time, there was an advanced degree you needed to actually be a professor, she was allowed to teach, but she was not given any pay. But in 1915, so this is the centenary, David Hilbert and Felix Klein, perhaps the two leading mathematicians of the time, invited her to the University of Göttingen to help them understand the theory of relativity, which will be the subject of tomorrow's lecture. And it was at that time that she developed and published her theorems that I'll try to describe. Finally, in 1919, she earned this advanced degree, the habilitation, over the objections of the faculty. And there's a famous faculty meeting where the professors basically say, well, we can't give a woman a habilitation because the next thing you know, there'll be a professor. And even worse, the next thing you know, they'll be in the faculty senate. And David Hilbert got up and said, gentlemen, this is a faculty senate. It is not a bathhouse. And then she went on to the foundations of abstract algebra. Finally, she was granted the position of extraordinary professor, which sounds great, but extraordinary professor means you still don't get paid. You just have privileges to teach. Finally, she, after the death of her father, she got paid a small stipend for teaching. Several other honors followed, but of course, the early 30s were a very difficult time for mathematicians in Germany, and Emmy had three strikes against her. She was female, she was Jewish, and she was a pacifist. So she was relieved of her duties, placed on a leave of absence, which basically meant she was fired. She tried to move to the Soviet Union, which is where her brother, younger brother, who was also a mathematician, moved. But in the end, she managed to secure a position in the U.S. at a women's college, Bryn Mawr College in Pennsylvania. And then very tragically, after surgery for an ovarian cyst, she somewhat mysteriously died a few days after the surgery, only age 53. Let me give you very quickly an overview of the two theorems, and I'll give some more details. The first theorem is the one that we already saw in the video. There's a correspondence between symmetries and conservation laws. And the word variational problem I'll go into is essential in that correspondence. The second theorem, less well known but equally important for physics, is that if the symmetry group is infinite dimensional, then there's a non-trivial differential relation among its Euler-Lagrange equations. In other words, the field theory has interesting relations, and this is exactly what happens in relativity. And in fact, one of the reasons for Hilbert to invite her to Göttingen was to resolve a paradox about the energy-momentum tensor in relativity, and her second theorem did that. I won't go into any more details about the second theorem in this lecture. One other thing that's even less recognized that she did, and I, after much investigation, came to the conclusion was she was the first one to introduce higher-order symmetries, and this was in order to establish this one-to-one correspondence. And these kind of got forgotten until the discovery of integrable systems and solitons in the mid-1960s. And I won't have, unfortunately, time to go into that, but those who would like to see the more technical lecture I've been asked to give on Wednesday are certainly invited there. This we'll see again, so this is a brief overview, but Ruth will have a similar overview. So symmetry under various groups, translations gives you linear momentum, time gives you energy, rotations give you angular momentum, and so on. Now, Emmy, as with all discoveries in science and mathematics, did not come up with this single-handedly. There were precursors, and gradually over the years, people started to understand that symmetry had something to do with conservation, and in fact, in special relativity, there was a paper of Herglotz where it led to the Poincaré invariance, the symmetry of special relativity led to 10 conservation laws, but it was Emmy Noether who realized these were all special cases of a very, very general theorem, and that's what we're here to celebrate. Later, the history turned very strange, so there was a very nice paper by a colleague of hers named Bessel-Hagen that slightly generalized her result. And then it kind of was mentioned intermittently, but not very well for the next almost 30 years. So many of the papers in physics did not even give her credit. They would mention, say, Bessel-Hagen without even mentioning Noether, even though Bessel-Hagen was very generous in his crediting of her. And in 1951, a physicist named Hill published what was basically a very special case of her theorem, namely only for geometrical symmetries, not these more general symmetries. And that led to a rash of papers in which people would publish a paper. They would read Hill's paper without reading Emmy Noether's original paper, and they would write down and publish a generalization of Noether's theorem, whereas what was actually true was they were proving a special case of the original full theorem. So the paper itself was cited, started to be increasingly cited, but was not understood. And I think it was only later in the 80s, through work of a number of people, and my book is an attempt to understand this, is that people really understood what she had done. But this persists today. Here's a very recent book where it's back to special cases again, claiming this is her general theorem. And then in other subjects, similar things happen, where people discovered relations between symmetry and conservation laws without realizing where they came from. So now, let me go through the three main ingredients of Noether's theorem. And as we've seen, so roughly speaking, it says to symmetries and conservation laws are in direct correspondence. But this requires an underlying form of the field equations of the physics, namely that they come from a variational principle. Without the variational principle, there is no direct link between symmetries and conservation laws. So let me start by briefly explaining what a variational principle is. And this goes way, way back, say, to Leibniz. This is a quote by one of the people who worked a mathematician in the calculus of variation. Leibniz conceives God in the creation of the world like a mathematician who is solving a minimum problem, or rather, in our modern phraseology, a problem in the calculus of variations. Okay? So God is solving a problem in the calculus of variations. Now we tend to put God aside and we say physics is solving a problem in the calculus of variation. And then I like this. The question being to determine among an infinite number of possible worlds, so this is the multi-universe, that for which the sum of necessary evil is a minimum. Voltaire made a bit of fun of Leibniz and his best of all possible worlds. Those of you who have read Candide know about this, of Dr. Pangloss. But let's pretend that nature is exactly of this form, as with physicists. So a physical system in equilibrium chooses the best of all possible worlds by minimizing some overall cost, energy or force or time or even money, say. And then there's the related principle of least action due to Maupertuis, another a French mathematician. And the analysis was developed by a whole series of very famous mathematicians. And here's some examples just to set the stage. So obviously, we grow up to learn that the shortest distance between two points is a straight line, right? This is a problem in the calculus of variations. Among all possible paths between the two points, the one that's the shortest in distance is the straight line. Now, to prove that mathematically is a non-trivial exercise. So sometimes things that are obvious to our intuition are not so obvious if you start to worry about the mathematical foundations. In fact, you've probably seen pictures like this when you're flying in the airplane and you say, wait a minute, shouldn't I be taking a straight line from New York to Paris? Well, because you're on a sphere, the shortest distance between two points on a sphere is a great circle. And when we project it onto a Mercator projection or something like that, we get something that looks circular. And one could do this in general. You don't have to live on a sphere. You could live on a very curved universe, or if you're a relativist, of course, the whole universe is curved. And then one travels, the light paths travel along what are called geodesics. They're the analogs of straight lines. So that's already a problem in the calculus of variations. Here's another familiar example. This is Fermat's principle in optics, that light travels along the path that takes the least time. So this light beam, with this piece of glass in the middle, to get from here to here, has chosen the path somehow in advance it knows which path is going to take the least amount of time. And we see effects like this when you have something in the water. If you like fishing, you know that where you see the fish underwater is not where you have to throw the lure. This is known as Snell's Law, or in France, the Loi de Descartes. Here's another beautiful example. They were threatening to have me do an experiment where I was going to draw a wire out of a soap dish and do this. I'm very happy they decided not to do this. As I said, I'm not a physicist or experimentalist. But the soap films formed spanning a wire are surfaces of minimal area. So they span the wire, and they have very beautiful, and there's actually been a lot of interesting mathematical developments in recent years about what are called minimal surfaces. So these are all examples of problems in the calculus of variations. And they all involve minimizing something, either distance or time or surface area. Now the one that, let me go very quickly through this, the one that started the subject is something called the brachistochrone problem. And here your problem is, so now it's definitely getting non-trivial. You want to get a bead sliding down a wire, starting here and ending up here, and you want the wire to be in the shape where the bead takes the least amount of time possible. And the answer, I'll give you the answer, it's a cycloid. So if you take a wheel, say a train, and it rolls along, and you follow one point on the wheel, it traces out a cycloid. If you turn that upside down, you get part of that. This problem has a famous history, and some famous people got it wrong. Galileo claimed it was a circular arc. It looks circular, but it's not. It was solved by the Dutch physicist Huygens, or Huygens as we tend to pronounce it in English. And this was a related problem, the tautochrone problem, which was how to design a pendulum. We saw a pendulum in such a way that it swings and it has exactly the same period. And it was this produced a great increase in accurate timekeeping and helped the British solve the problem of the longitude, which led to the dominance of the British Navy. Then there was a contest in 1696 with the original problem, and you can see how famous this problem is. You've got Newton, Leibniz, one of the Bernoullis, and some other reasonably well-known mathematicians all sending in entries. Okay, so let me briefly review. How do you minimize a function? So this is the idea. Think of it, we're trying to minimize distance, say. Well, if you look at the minimum, the first thing you notice is the tangent line is horizontal. Now, one of the first things you learn in calculus is the slope of the tangent line has to do with the derivative of the function. And so one gets this famous first derivative test. The derivative. If you haven't seen derivatives before, don't worry. Concentrate on the slope of the line. Okay? But of course, the same thing holds at maxima and even at inflection points. So one has to be a bit careful. I don't want to go into the details of the math here, but just to warn you, the things start looking simple and immediately complications come. How about something more complicated? How do you find the peaks in a mountain range? Well, these are the same as the maxima of the height function. Well, one solution would be that the tangent plane is horizontal at the peak, just like the line was horizontal. But that's not a good solution for going to the calculus of variations. A better solution is to remember about the gradient. So the gradient is the vector that points in the direction of steepest increase, uphill. So if you're climbing uphill as fast as possible, you're climbing in the direction of the gradient. And hence, the equivalent of the first derivative test is at the top of the mountain, the gradient has to be zero. It's also true at the bottom of valleys. And then the calculus of variations generalizes this from one and two-dimensional problems to infinite dimensional problems because we have infinite dimension worth of curves that we need to compare. And if one follows the definition of the gradient very carefully, one ends up with the functional gradient. And setting this to be zero gives you a system of differential equations or field equations whose solution are the minimizers. And this is basically at the heart of modern physics. And the next phase is that we should incorporate symmetries into the variational principle. So one minimizes something through a variational principle. To solve it, you get a system of field equations. Okay. Let me briefly discuss symmetry and conservation laws much quicker. So symmetry is in mathematics relies on what's known as group theory. And this started life in the work of Abel and Galois, who were interested in solving polynomial equations. And you may have heard that while you can solve quadratic equations, you learn to do this in high school, and maybe you don't learn it, but maybe you've heard you can solve cubic equations and quartic equations, but you get stuck at degree 5. There is no formula for the solution of a fifth degree polynomial in algebraic terms. And what Galois and Abel realized was this depended on the symmetries. A very famous Norwegian mathematician named Sophus Lie did the same thing for differential equations, and he also started investigating variational principles. And it's the methods of Lie that Emmy Noether ended up applying in her famous theorems. So here we have conservation laws. And then symmetry started to take over physics in the hands of Hermann Weyl, we met before, Wigner, many others. And physicists resisted this. There's a famous quote by an American physicist named Slater about der Gruppenpest. Pest means plague. So the plague of symmetry was infesting physics, but the physicists couldn't resist. And it is where it is today. This is just a quick quote about groups being of great significance. Maybe we'll quickly skip that. There are two types of symmetries I want to discuss very briefly. The ones that don't figure in Noether's theorem are discrete symmetry groups. So for instance, the symmetries of a square. You can rotate by 90 degrees, 180 degrees, 270 degrees. The ones that do figure in Noether's theorem, oh, this is a more complicated discrete symmetry group. This is a model built by one of my students. Are the continuous symmetry groups, and these are the groups that Sophus Lie introduced. So if you have a circle, you can rotate by any amount. In other words, the symmetries are continuously dependent on the angle of rotation. And these are the ones that show up in Noether's theorem. Finally, a very brief history of conservation laws. Again, there's all kinds of precedents. Conservation of momentum is fairly early, Newton and even before Newton. Conservation of mass apparently came up first in chemistry with the experiments of Lavoisier, or the Russians claim that Lomonosov predated Lavoisier. Conservation of energy has a more interesting history, and there's a good claim that it really, in its modern form, only goes back to Helmholtz in the mid-1800s, mid-19th century. So in summary, Noether's theorem says that to each continuous symmetry group, so think again of the rotations, of the variational principle or the action functional, you need that for this to work, there is a conservation law. In the case of rotations, it's conservation of angular momentum. And vice versa. And for this, she had to generalize the notion of symmetry. So this is... Well, I hesitate showing this in front of an audience of physicists, but anyway, you can shoot me down during the panel discussion. This is what I think of as the modern manual for physics. To construct a physical theory nowadays, step one is you determine what type of symmetries you're going to allow. So translations in space and time, probably, rotations, probably, maybe conformal transformations, and then you start going on more and more exotic types of transformation, supersymmetry, which we've heard of in earlier talks, string theory type groups of getting more and more exotic, some of them infinite dimensional, and they'll be covered by Noether's second theorem. Secondly, you construct a variational principle that admits the given symmetry group, so now you have to start getting your hands dirty. How do I construct such a variational principle? To me, this is the theory of differential invariance, but physicists are extremely good at getting their hands dirty, finding the variational principle. Now you invoke Noether, namely, nature is obsessed with minimization, so the field equations, Maxwell's equations, or equations of general relativity, or whatever your physical theory is, the equations of string theory, come from minimizing that variational principle, constructing the functional gradient, you get differential equations. And you immediately, from Noether's first and second theorems, you get conservation laws and differential identities satisfied by the field equations. And then, of course, the most difficult step of all is to actually solve the field equations. but even very special solutions, like, say, a black hole, are of immense importance. And I've stolen this slide, well, with his permission, from Neil. Those of you who were here earlier in the conference already saw a version of this slide. There's a variational principle that, quote unquote, incorporates all known physics. And now you follow that program. It's got the symmetries built in. You can write out the field equations. They're much more complicated, but you know automatically there are these conservation laws and identities. And with that, I will pass the floor over to Ruth. And thank you very much.
So thank you, Peter, for giving a very clear overview of Noether's theorems and introducing all the key mathematical concepts. What I want to do now is to pick apart what Peter has been talking about and to actually discuss the impact of Noether in physics and to try and get across a feel about what these things are and what they mean, these symmetries and these conservation laws. I'll probably also inevitably come up with a few personal either recollections or reflections on Emmy Noether. I think I was shockingly ignorant about Emmy before I actually started to prepare this talk. I first heard of her in a lecture in my second year at university. I actually did do a maths degree, even though I'm a physicist, when the lecturer who I had quite a good friendship with sort of said the only contribution to mathematics from a woman, and then turned around and I could see his shoulder shaking because, of course, he was basically baiting probably the only woman in the audience, or maybe one of the very few at that point. So one thing I've come to appreciate is that she really was a very remarkable woman indeed. So if there are three things, I'm always told, like with a sermon, you've got to have 3 points, because people can only ever take 3 points away. So these are my sermon points. This is what I want you to take away. It's hard to overestimate the importance of Noether's work or Noether's insights in modern physics. It really is key and fundamental. So I kind of want you to feel just how vital her insights were. These insights on symmetry underlie our methods, our theories, and our intuition, even to the point at which we have a mathematician trying to break down into an algorithm how to do theoretical physics. And finally, this link between symmetry and conservation, which was so beautifully shown in that opening video, is actually how we end up describing our world. So these are that's really the message that I want you to take home. Right, let me start picking apart things. Conservation laws, what are they? We mean something very specific in physics when we talk about a conservation law. You know, we just saw derivatives, something had a static point. But really, we're very much aware about conservation laws. Here, I've put up a few things, just really picked 3 sayings at random, all of which embody what a conservation law really is, which is essentially, you can't get something for nothing. That's really what a conservation law is about. And there are so many other examples. So what about symmetry? Well, Hermann Weyl actually came up with a nice little set of rules that tell us what a symmetry is. Symmetry is about an object that turns out to be symmetric. Great flag, by the way. I really love your flag. Fantastic. Much better than ours. Secondly, you need an operation or procedure. We call it an operation in mathematics. In this case, it's reflection. If you put a vertical line and reflect the flag around that, that's your operation, reflection. And finally, the observers, decide that after this reflection, nothing has changed. And I'm not going to get into details about stitching around the side of the flag or stuff like that. We're being impressionistic here. So that is what a symmetry is. And as Peter mentioned, we've got two sorts of symmetry. I sort of feel a bit like Sheldon Cooper's Fun with Flags here, you know, but nonetheless, Fun with Flags. Here is talking about symmetries. Symmetries can be distinct operations. We can have discrete symmetries. We can pick up our idealized Union Jack and turn it round through 90 degrees. We can reflect it. But these are sort of a finite set of operations. Or we've got this continuous, which is smooth. We can twist as much or as little as we like, and we do it smoothly, continuously. And Noether's symmetries are about these smooth or continuous symmetries. So let's now start to put these together. I thought this was just such a great visualization about what the connection was between our conservation law, in this case of energy, and our symmetry, which in this case is something that we call, in physics, time translation symmetry. Now, the reason why I think this is a good one to try and pick apart is because it's perhaps not entirely obvious if you haven't sort of had your mind warped by the training of theoretical physics. We kind of got a notion of conservation of energy, but what's happening with time translation symmetry? It looks like things are actually changing here. So let's again dig a little deeper and try and think about this. What's going on? Where's the link between energy and time? Okay, energy. Great photo. She looks so cheesed off in the front, doesn't she? One of the problems with grasping this link is that energy is an incredibly intuitive concept. We really feel it. Energy is something that's very direct. We know what it is. Some of us wake up in the morning and we're like, there's a little brother. We're full of beans. Not me. I'm more like this. I need kickstarting with a few cups of coffee, so perimeter is perfect for that. On the other hand, time is something we experience. So please forgive me for this personal montage, but I sort of thought if I poached photos off the web, I didn't want to get into copyright issues. So you see here that something that everybody in this room, it's a sort of general common experience. We are born, we have a childhood, we have an adolescence, which I think that's probably dating me, don't look. Then we become, at least in my case, research students, having some very fun professors around. Finally, if we're very lucky, we have our own children who then grow up. And finally, very scary, this was taken just a few days ago, the children actually come to finish and graduate their own undergraduate degrees. It's this continual experience. So it's obviously different from the pendulum, it's much more complex, but there's also this idea of repetition. If nothing changed, which is somehow what you think of as being meant by time symmetry, time translation symmetry, how could we know time had passed? Well, what's really going on is it's a little more subtle. There is a time symmetry, but it's slightly hidden. In the case of the pendulum looks like it's changing in time, but in fact, it's repeating the same motion again and again and again. So there is a time translation symmetry there. It's exchanging kinetic potential energy, so it whooshes through the bottom of its swing, and it went at minimal potential, it pauses at the edge of its swing, at maximal potential, minimum kinetic energy. But in the video, we saw a wrecking ball swing across a canyon, and the video is careful to say it was in vacuum. So if the time translation symmetry, we don't know if we've walked in when it's just been set off, or if it's been going a million years. And why is that? That's because the laws of physics haven't changed over time. We've still got the same laws of physics now as when the dinosaurs were here, or even as when the sun was formed. At least that's what we believe. And so the time translation symmetry is there. It's just perhaps slightly more. You have to kind of think and just peel apart and look behind the curtain to see it. But we do have this repetition in time. So that gives an idea about how to link time to energy. And it's also giving an idea about what's behind the Noether theorem. But Noether really actually works for us, works much harder and much better than that. And it works with the building blocks of nature. So nurture and nature. Quite often, where we see Noether in action is in the laws of nature. And as we all know, we can't change the laws of physics. So, except we got good old Scotty teaching us physics. So, where do we see Noether in terms of modern theoretical physics? I suggested that energy and time were a good example because the symmetry was a little bit hidden, but it wasn't too far hidden. We could at least see that it was there. I think most of the symmetries of nature are much more obscure, except if you're one of the initiates and you've actually gone through the process of sweating through all these equations. So let me at least try and get across these hidden symmetries in the context of something that is reasonably familiar, electric charge and electromagnetism. And it's quite appropriate, perhaps, to be talking about Maxwell's equations here. So Faraday discovered that electricity and magnetism were related, and one could look like the other if things were in motion. Maxwell expressed these equations mathematically. So this is a modern way of expressing them. If equations freak you, don't worry. E stands for electric, so far so good. B, for whatever reason, stands for magnetic. But you notice that while in the first column they're kind of getting on with business, in the second column they talk to each other. So irrespective of what these things mean, you've got an E on one side and a B on the other side of the equals sign. That's telling us that these fields are not independent. They know about each other. And what that then allows us to do, we always want to try and dig and find something a bit more fundamental, we actually find that they can both these quite different fields, can be written in terms of a single thing, a single potential. Now, you might think, ooh, I don't know what a potential is, but actually you do. If you saw this sign, you wouldn't run up and grab a hold of a power cable, right? That is what potential is. A power cable is an example of a potential difference. So here are birds on a wire. That's a fairly common sight. And they're at a different potential. And it is in the potential that the symmetry lies. So the birds are sitting on the wire, and they're not getting fried. And we're on the ground, and we're not getting fried. At least, as long as we're not stupid enough to touch the wires, we're not getting fried. And so whether we're at ground state or at some 50,000 volts or whatever, it doesn't really matter. We just shift our ground state. We shift our level. And locally, things are OK. We don't get fried. So that's a symmetry. That's one of those discrete symmetries going from ground to the wire. But Noether is not just about discrete symmetries, and electromagnetism is not just about us on the ground and birds on a wire. In fact, there is a whole continuous symmetry where if we just slowly rewrite our potential, in a very specific way, admittedly, but if we slowly rewrite our potential, we still see the same electric and magnetic fields. And that is the symmetry of nature. It's really quite quite a remarkable thing. Sometimes I think, you know, as physicists, we kind of take these things for granted. So we call this internal symmetry. We've got two different ways of naming it. In this case, we call it a phase because it's simply a number that's sort of telling us something about how we have ordered the details of our electromagnetic field. If we change this phase, we get, it shuffles details, but it doesn't change the field itself. And it's really like an internal angle. We can think about where we are on a wave, say an electromagnetic wave or something, or where we are in an internal space, some internal angle. And changing phase is just changing perspective. If I'm looking at waves and I step a meter to the right, they're the same waves. They haven't changed. It's just my view of them that's changed. And that's like shifting these waves. So that's what a change of phase is. And we call this, we get technical and we call it gauge. Nothing to do with model railways. At least I don't think so. This was actually used quite effectively in a Star Trek. Usually, if there's an idea in physics, it turns up somewhere in science fiction, and Star Trek's usually very good for it. So Geordi and Ensign Roe somehow had an accident and ended up out of phase with the rest of the Enterprise. And in this case, they imagined this as not being able to communicate. But it's kind of this idea of things just being different. You know, maybe if you could only look forward, you wouldn't know if someone was 1 meter to the left of you. But, let's not get into the science of Star Trek here. This gauge symmetry, this really is what is underlying our theories of modern physics. So we've got, it's the underlying theme behind the standard model of particle interactions, the Higgs mechanism, and of course, Einstein's general relativity. So I'd like to just sort of say a few words, at least about two of these things. So for particle physics, for the standard model, what does Noether do for us? Well, like conservation of charge, electric charge, there are other symmetries in nature which are even more hidden than that potential. So we've gone from this slightly hidden time to this very mysterious phase, and now I'm telling you there's something even worse. Well, that's the way it is. So we only know about these symmetries that are hidden because we have conservation law. So here is Noether's insight coming in and telling us something's going on. So what are these laws? Well, they're rules that tell us certain things either can or can't happen. So for example, two blue-eyed parents cannot have a brown-eyed child. That's something that we kind of are familiar with, but it's the same sort of idea in particle interactions. Two particles may not be able to interact to produce a third. Some are allowed and some aren't. Another thing that happens is that particles tend to line up. We like to spot patterns. We're very good at pattern spotting. And these patterns that we find in nature reflect the underlying symmetry. So although the proton and neutron might seem different, one's charged, one's neutral, they have very nearly the same mass. And this led Heisenberg to think of them as being, well, what if they're actually, they are the same particle in some sense, but there's some internal symmetry relating the two of them. So we're kind of where one, maybe it's like an internal spin, where one's spin up and the other is spin down. So who knows why he came to think of this at the time. There was no reason to think of the nucleons as being having little constituent particles, but nonetheless, thinking of them in this way led to isospin, and if you indeed look now at our more modern picture of a proton and neutron, where we believe there are little quarks inside, you see indeed the difference between the proton and the neutron is an up has gone to a down. So it's remarkable, really, that insight led us, you know, is actually really borne out by what we believe is there. So over the sort of 40s and 50s, more and more particles were discovered, and by looking at their rules of interaction, their allowed interactions, we gradually built up patterns, pictures, these patterns of particles. And inside, underlying these patterns of particles, we can deduce what symmetries are hidden, these Noether symmetries. So that, this logical conclusion, led us to the Standard Model. And so we've had various talks today about the Standard Model, and it's been tested fabulously well in the LHC. So it was Noether's insights, nudged along the way, of course, by some excellent theoretical physicists, that gave us our fundamental theory of particle interactions. General relativity is a bit of a different beast. It really explains the large scale. It explains the universe from practically its very beginning to now. That's essentially everything that we know or we could ever know. It's tested in our solar system, and it's actually used. It's got a practical application in terms of GPS. So general relativity is best summed up by saying space tells matter how to move, matter tells space how to curve. The problem with this, sounds nice, doesn't it, is that gravity is highly nonlinear. So what's nonlinearity? Well, again, I always like to go back to my sayings. Nonlinearity is a stitch in time saves nine. This idea, a little action now can have large consequences later. And so here we kind of see this animation of a band of light with passing behind a black hole. So it's linear, would expect something to be straight. That's what linear kind of embodies. Nonlinearity, we've got the black hole and we've got this huge effect, which is called gravitational lensing. Now, of course, to produce something like that, you have to know how to solve Einstein's equations and how to deduce what happens to the light. And so this is where Noether comes in. She's absolutely key. You sit down, you start trying to solve a problem in physics, you're almost inevitably led to what can I use, what symmetries have I got, how can I use these to break down this nonlinear problem. And I just want to finish the sort of physics bit by focusing on Noether in action in the solar system. So we'll talk about planetary orbits. So the fact that if I look around me, point in different directions, the laws of physics don't depend on whether my arm is sort of out to the side or sitting in front. So the laws of physics are rotationally symmetric. This gives us a conservation law, which is angular momentum. So we see this all the time if we watch the Winter Olympics with the figure skating. A skater will start, not me, I'll just fall, but a skater will start turning around and she'll be going fairly slowly, pull your arms in and you go very, very fast. And so that's the notion of conservation of angular momentum. And it's the same with the planets. So if we look at the solar system, angular momentum being conserved means that the speed of the Earth is faster when it's closer to the Sun. Now, fortunately for you guys, this is during winter, so you have a shorter winter, and I can tell you, I appreciate that when I visit here in winter. Another thing that's perhaps less familiar, though, is that energy conservation, or the equivalent of energy conservation here, tells us, if we look at what happens to the time bit of this problem, it tells us the clocks actually tick slower nearer the Sun. Again, it's a really very simple, very quick application of Noether's ideas to gravity in the solar system. And both of these have been used to verify general relativity. So I just want to sort of start to close now by sort of trying to just say a few more general words about Emmy Noether. You've heard about her life, her biography, you've heard how she worked and wasn't paid, and it all sounds very shocking, doesn't it, to our ears? But I think what we have to remember is we're all products of our own times. And I actually went and Googled to find my own home institution that I studied at. At my institution, Cambridge, women could study, so at least they weren't locked up in a lunatic asylum for wanting to study, from about the mid-19th century. But they were not awarded degrees until 1948. So at least Noether did get a PhD. And to some extent, yes, she didn't get paid, but that was because people probably hadn't thought about women being professors and teaching. She changed that. She changed the world that she lived in, and she changed it for the better and for all of us. So we're now in the situation where this is my my group in Durham, in both, which spans across both mathematics and physics departments, as indeed I do. The women in mathematical physics, we're all promoted. It's not that these people are sort of teaching slaves or anything. We are all, I'm not really sure how it translates, associate professors or higher. There's four full professors there. And as you see, six women, it's a reasonably decent showing. It could be better, true, but I think rather than thinking it could be better, I think we should think, wow, we've got six women, we've got a good representation of girls in the group, and they're all promoted. They're all sort of senior women. You know, they're all well valued. So that is Noether's legacy, and I honestly think she would have been really jazzed if she could see this slide. I think this would have been her real sort of indication, you know, these girls didn't have to fight to get paid. So finally, why maybe have we not heard about her so much? Well, we talk about Noether's theorem, not Noether's theory. And of course, we know we tend to talk about theories in physics. Noether was a mathematician, pure mathematician, and mathematicians tend to deal with truths rather than descriptions. But her theorem actually gave us something far more valuable. It gave us insight. It gave us something which pervades, you know, all the other theories. So, you know, I think what we should do is really just celebrate a wonderful lady and always try to remember to recognize achievement in all its forms. Thank you. Pretty much in part. Make a joke about the belt.
Of course.
I just want to say, please don't feel this black belt is meant to intimidate you from asking questions. It's actually, it's just a prop because obviously the AV people, you know, weren't quite expecting a dress, you know? So.
Well, okay, we'll open the floor to questions. So if you have a question, you can make your way to the microphone. And why don't I start with a question from the online discussion forum. And here's the question. And maybe we'll let each of you respond. And we'll start with, Peter, we'll let you jump back in. So you can start. What is the most significant result today coming from Noether's merging of symmetry and conservation laws?
What is the most...
most significant result today?
I'm not sure what I would classify as the most significant. I think, as Ruth was saying, the fact that she gave the structure behind how you view physics and how you incorporate symmetry and conservation laws. But that's not a specific result. I don't know, maybe Ruth has a...
I suppose it depends on whether you're a physicist and a mathematician, you know, as to which you think is the most. I guess I would have to vote for the standard model, because I think that's where we see most clearly, you know, the impact of her way of thinking. And it has been remarkably well tested. So,
thank you. Let's go to the question in-house.
So it seems to me that a strategy for scientists when they're doing their work is to look for patterns in nature. Did Emmy Noether play a part in creating or developing the strategy?
I think you're more the expert.
I would say no. The period of her life that led up to this paper with the two theorems in it did not seem to... It had an influence beyond itself, but in terms of her own career, that was basically the end. And she went on to develop abstract algebra, which has very little in common with the theorems that play such an important role in physics. So I would say no, but it did have an impact in... particularly in Hilbert and Hermann Weyl and so on, so in the mathematicians contributing to physics, yes, but not directly in her own work. There's this one paper, and then she goes on to do rings and Noetherian rings and all sorts of other abstract things that have, at least so far, not nearly the impact in physics that her theorems had.
Yeah, I think she was very much a pragmatist. Sorry, she had solved the problem, moved on.
Very good. You know what? That is actually leads right into another online question from the Twitter feed. The question is, what was Noether like as a person? So, Ruth, do you want to carry on, and then we'll go to Peter?
Yeah. So, I think one of the things that charmed me when I was looking, you know, Googling and trying to find out more information about her, was that she seems to have been absolutely passionate about her mathematics. You know, she really loved what she did. Well, I guess you'd have to if you weren't being paid, but still doing it. And she was very charismatic. Her students loved her. They were called Noether's boys. And they seemed to sort of really, you know, come and learn from her. And she seemed to be generous as well with her time. She seemed to be a truly great mentor. So that was what I got out of it anyway. I don't know whether...
I would say she was passionate about mathematics to the exclusion of almost everything else that one might pay attention to. She was also well known to be a terrible lecturer, except with this small group of Noether's boys that Ruth mentioned. And they went on, it was through them, people like van der Waerden and so on, that the influence in mathematics spread. So she had this small group of close disciples. Those who got into the group thought the world of her, but those who weren't able to get into the group, they couldn't make much sense of her, because the descriptions of her lecturing ability, if she had been subject to student evaluations in her courses at Bryn Mawr, she would not have survived very long.
Okay, and again, from the online forum, this directed to Dr. Oliver, there's a story of Emmy interrupting a friend during a talk to share a new, better way of attacking a particular problem. Is this true, and can you elaborate? And how profound was the insight? So does that ring a bell?
I honestly don't. I don't know this story.
Yeah, I heard that one.
It sounds vaguely familiar, but I don't know the details of the story.
It feels true, doesn't it?
Yeah, it certainly feels true, knowing her.
Yeah.
Knowing her personality and her character and so on. I would, but there's many of these apocryphal. I suppose in physics there are also apocryphal stories, but in mathematics there are all these apocryphal stories about mathematicians, which even if they're not true, they should be true.
Oh, wonderful. Well, let's end on a question for both of you to address. And it comes again from the online forum. I find it very inspirational to see great scientists finding inspiration from other scientists. Could you each share what you found most inspirational about Emmy?
So on the mathematical side, the inspiration was actually going back to her paper and realizing how profound her insight had been. And instead of basing it on other people's opinions of even other second generation opinions, when you go back to the original sources and you really understand the genius that's behind there. So I think that was, to me, the most affecting part of it. And then playing an important role in my own work subsequent to that. I spent many papers developing the ideas of Emmy Noether in other directions, not just physics, but continuum mechanics and elasticity, et cetera, et cetera. And this is really where I felt her influence in my own career.
Fantastic. And Dr. Gregory?
I think I'd probably like to probably pick more on her as a person, or as a woman indeed, in that I think what really struck me was the fact that she just, you know, as you say, passionate about mathematics almost to the exclusion of all else, but the fact that she didn't allow social convention to inhibit or to limit her. She just said, well, I'm going to do what I want to do, and if I get recognition, fine, but that's not what I'm in it for. I'm in it for the love of what I do, and that, I think, is what I like and what resonates for me. Yep.
Fantastic. Ladies and gentlemen, let's thank Dr. Oliver and Dr. Ruth Gregory.